ओके दिस प्रोफेसर विश्वास फ्रॉम कंप्यूटर साइंस डिपार्टमेंट आईआईटी बॉम्बे. आई एम अबाउट टू स्टार्ट द कोर्स. ओके सो दिस कोर्स इज अबाउट और दीज थ्री लेक्चर्स इन मॉड्यूल वन विच आई एम ऑफरिंग इज अबाउट लीनियर डेटा स्ट्रक्चर्स एंड एप्लीकेशंस. सो आई हैव अज्यूम दैट देर इज सम फेमिलियरिटी दैट यू नो यू विल नीड टू हैव. फॉर एग्जाम्पल आई एक्सपेक्ट दैट यू नो समथिंग अबाउट सी प्लस प्लस. Okay. So what about C++? I'm not going to teach C++ from scratch. So for example, I will not do, you know, routine things like talking about loops, data types and things like that. I'll assume that you know it. Okay, and I'll assume some basics of algorithms, which means you know how to do simple searching, sorting. More importantly, you know how to analyze simple algorithms. So the asymptotic O notation, big O notation, is going to be used for my course. Okay. So I hope you are, so let's formally begin then the course. You have seen slide 2, I'm moving on to slide 3. This basically says why data structures are very important for anyone doing programming. Okay. So though we will be doing toy problems sort of in the course, because we have very little time to develop full-fledged applications. However, you can observe the bullets 2 and 3, which say basically that people have discovered many interesting data structures over a period of time. Okay. Some of them have lost significance and are obsolete, but many of them carry on. And in this course, we'll be looking at those data structures that have survived and have found use in many different. So eventually, once you have done this module and done some practice, interest of this material will be in designing applications, more importantly, in choosing data structures. Okay. So choice of data structures is intimately connected with choosing an algorithm also. They go hand in hand. And wherever possible, even in this small way, I would like to pick up those issues, take a simple problem, look at alternatives. Slide 5 says much the same thing. Okay. And the one in bold tells us that data structures are fun to some people, but generally they are also very useful stuff. Okay. So I'll begin really the course formally by saying that for this module and the one which we'll do subsequently, I'll assume that data structure is defined by or is represented by three important components, triples. First, we must have a large set of values, okay, which are important for the application in which we are working. Secondly, the values must be from a known type world. So here I'll give an example later. Okay, the types could be built-in types of a language like C++. The type could also be things that we will introduce in the course. So a matrix type, your type, my type, whatever you want, whatever application. Okay, so our type will also have to follow these three things. We must have a large set of values, hopefully. We must have a type which is well defined. And most importantly, or not the least importantly, is that we must define very clearly the operations that can be done on this universe of values belonging to the data type that we have chosen. So three things, and I'll reinforce this whenever I need to. I'll move on. So here is the first example, just to substantiate what I said. For us, the data structure could be illustrated by many different types of C++. I've chosen a simple one, which is called unsigned short. So there are many equivalent ones, signed short, signed end, unsigned end, long, 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 and so on. This is one data type. So the data type now comes with a lot of, you know, sort of bundled information. For example, on my machine, unsigned short or short type is only of 2 bytes. 2 bytes means exactly 16 bits. So 16 bits are given to represent unsigned numbers. Unsigned numbers have the characteristic that they start with 0, which is the smallest value, and they go to the largest value which is possible in that data type. Clearly, since there are only 16 bits, the ranges of integers that we can model using short is 0 as the smallest number and 2 to the power 16 minus 1 as the largest number. So observe, as soon as you define a data type, the range of values are fixed. no value beyond 0 to 216 minus 1 is representable as unsigned short. Okay. There is a name for the type short. In this case, type. In this case, it is unsigned short. And you can see a list of operations are given, which are mostly covering all the important operations that you can use to operate over unsigned short. Observe, some of these are binary. Most of these are binary: addition, subtraction, multiplication, division, modulo. However, there are some unary operators also, like plus plus, minus minus, and different. So this is the kind of thing that we'd like to build for ourselves as we go along. A data structure should have all three things clearly stated: the values, the type that we are naming it as, and the operations. So most of the built-in types of the language are supposed to be scalars. Scalars means that they have exactly one value from a set of values. Okay, and we'll see how we expand it later. Now I'm going to do a very quick recap of arrays. Okay, I'm assuming you know arrays, but I just want to examine it from my viewpoint so that I can use it the way I want it. Apart from scalar data structures, array is also a data structure. Okay, the first difference is array is not a single value, it's a collection of values. Array has data types from a has a fixed data type, which means all its values are of the coming from the same universe, homogeneous collection. By definition, there are exceptions, but I'll stick to the normal thing. An array is supposed to be a finite collection, which means that we must know in advance what is the size of the collection that we want to work with. A consequence of finiteness and some other properties of the array is that traditionally, ever since it was introduced in Fortran 2, the first arrays, it was always contiguous, which means they laid out in memory side by side. So I put some questions out there on slide number 9, which instead of discussing it bullet by bullet, I'll move over to my example, and I will have to figure out how, if you have a question, how do I answer them. So look at this simple example which I have chosen. It illustrates many features of arrays. The first line, for example, declares small a, okay, that is the name, to be an array of integers of finite size 10, and it is also initialized with values which is given on the right hand side of assignment. The values, for example, are a0 gets the value 1, a1 gets the value 2, and the last value a9, which is the 10th element of the array, gets the value 10. Observe that arrays can have several different data types. The very next one says string str defines a string array of size 5. Okay, strings are known in C++. I'm assuming that you know it, and I've initialized this array with some strings, which are typically names of languages. The next one initiates or creates an array of floating point numbers or real numbers. The collection size is 6, and the values are initialized using floating point constants of both forms which are allowed in the language. But arrays are not only about scalar data types or built-in data types. The next one, for example, which says triple CORD5, supposed to define an array named COM, collection size is 5, and its elements are of a type called triple. Okay, triple are typically three valued entities. So clearly this array would not be declared as valid unless we go and define a class named triple, which will allow objects of type triple to be created. So I have to create my own class triple, give a definition, and then I can create an array of objects of type triple. So arrays can be created over R objects also. The next ones I'm going to skip, but it shows that array can be an array of pointers also. But since I'm not doing pointers now, I'll skip. Okay. And the remaining few lines are actually using a function and trying to. So the next one, if you have not heard, I'll just summarize what I said in the slide. We are showing how an integer array can be declared and initialized. Our string array can be declared and initialized. How a floating point array can be declared, how an array of my type, which is triple, can be initialized, array of pointers and so on. The next slide I'm going to skip. There is not too much. It only shows how you can do input output. For reading, you read into the locations A of I, where I varies as you want. Similarly, for displaying or printing, you can write out the ith element of the array by routinely moving I and running down the entire array. Okay, so this is a very quick recap, I know, but that's all that I need to move ahead with doing some problem solving. The next one I skip. In whichever implementation you have, if you run my program or a similar program, you will see kind of things that I have shown out there. The output of the program if things were running fine. Okay, two, three small things with arrays before I move on. So this is all about C++ and arrays. Okay, this may not be true for other languages. So when you refer to to array location A of I, the question is, what happens if I is not a valid index of the array? What do I mean? Suppose I declare an array of integer array of size 10, int A 10, initialize it with appropriate values, which are 0 to whatever, and then I access the array element A of 0, which is fine, A of 5, which is fine, A of 9, which is fine, but what if I access A of 100? So the point is, I have declared array with indices 0 to 9 and I will access 100, or I access A to the A of minus 100. Okay. The point is, what do I expect? So the problem with C++ language is, or it's not a problem, it's a decision of the language designers, that array accesses out of the range of the declared indices would not be considered as a compile time error. Why? Because compiler does not check for it at all. You can write A of I and put any value of I. The compiler will produce an array reference, go to a location and try and pick it up, and therefore undesirable things may happen, which is what the second bullet says. So if by going to or trying to index an array with an element with index which is way outside your range, it is possible that you have landed into somebody else's area, and therefore you could get a thing called segmentation fault. So you can check it out, those of you who are curious. For example, you can try this, write a small loop for I equals 0 to say 9, I equals 0, I less than 10. You can access A from anywhere to anywhere and see what happens. You will probably see, depending on the OS you use, something similar to what I've said. So we in IIT Bombay use only open source software. So our bread and butter C++ compiler is G++, which is there somewhere at the bottom of the slide, and I'm very comfortable with it. If you use Windows software, then you'll have to check out whether the messages are similar to what I'm saying or not. It may not be. But the point with C++ is, it's the language designer's decision that array references will not be checked at compile time, as a result of which either the user checks it himself or herself by putting an appropriate if then else condition, or it will produce a runtime error if you go beyond your. So this is all about arrays. If anybody has a quick question on arrays, I can take it up. Just to check whether you are able to hear me out or anything, can I have some question from one of you participants somewhere? So any question, technical or otherwise, about the audio, video reception, the quality, hearing, and so on. Okay, so there is a question I can see. I'll repeat that. So from GCKA, the question is there a limit on the size of the array? Okay, so it's not a good thing to do, but I'll put that as a question itself. Okay, can you figure out on your implementation, is there a limit on the size of the array? So how do you do? The language does not define. So the language leaves it to the implemented system to check whether things can work. So what you can do is just write a dummy code, a simple program like int main, etc. Put the array size as 1 million, some int A array 1 million. You can proceed. You can keep doing this. There could be, if there is a problem of a size somewhere, either the compiler or the runtime system will tell you, sorry, this cannot be compiled or executed. So there is no a priori fixed size of an array. The array size is dictated by what happens under you, which means how much memory has been given to a process. That memory decides the amount of, the size of array you can create, one or more. Okay, there's another question, I'll take this up also. Is string data type in C++? Okay, it all depends on how pure answer you want. String is a data type in C++, but it's not a native data type. Okay. So some smart person has implemented a library, and once you do hash include string, that library gets pulled in, and then you can use string as if it's a built-in data type. And I'm going to talk a little about it, not today, but maybe in lecture 2, which we'll have on the next week, where I talk about pointers and strings in much more detailed manner. So string is a data type for us as far as we are concerned, because we are going to utilize it. Okay, so just to check out whether this interface is working or not. So if you do this, so something like this, you can write string s, provided what I have written above is not at all visible clearly. Let me write more slowly. So this is hash, then I write include include, okay, and then you use this library, which is string. Of course, you need something else, which we'll see later. So to answer the question and move out of question mode, the point is, yes, string for us, for the purpose of the course, unless you're very technically interested in know what it is a data type for us, but we need to borrow it from whoever has implemented and made it available. It's a part of the standard C++ package. So with this small background of arrays, which is essentially not a part of this course as I planned it, but to take you along with me, I enter now this data structure called a linear list. This is a fairly formally defined data structure. See the way it's defined. We know that list is a collection of elements, okay, but it need not be an array. A list is independent of the representation. So list will comprise of some finite collection, say n elements. Okay. Here I have used x1 to xn as the named elements of the list. The most important criteria of a linear list is what it writes below, that the elements are ordered by position, not values, not sorted. Okay. So the first element of the list, the second element of the list, third element of the list, and the last element of the list. So observe that the first element does not have anything before it, being first. The last element has nothing following it. But every other element in a linear list has exactly one predecessor, one before, and exactly one successor, one after. So for xi, xi minus 1 is the unique predecessor of the ith element, and xi plus 1 is a unique successor. So that's all. It's a linear collection of elements in which there is a total ordering among the elements in the list. That's why it is linear. So with this simple description, I move on. I have already said this. Now look at only this part of it, that an array is one way of implementing a linear list, and we are going to see in this course primarily other ways of implementing linear lists. Look at slide number 17. So it says that while linear list could be, dictated by many different ways, a lot of different variations of the list can be created. By tradition, by legacy, those linear lists are found to be more important where the two ends of the list, the first is one end, the last is another end, are used to do the operations. Okay. And more importantly, unlike an array, insertion and deletion are fundamental operations on a linear list, which means a list which grows and shrinks. Okay? It can grow enormously and it can shrink back to almost null or empty list is quite common for this data. And this is what is the main theme of today, that we want to do some special linear list data structures. One is called a stack, the other is called a queue. There are many others which I'm not going to say, and there is something called a deck, which also I'm not going to discuss. Okay, so the stack, you observe, it says that one end of the list is active for a stack, the other end is sort of frozen, you don't use it now. So only one end operation is a stack, a both end operation is a queue, but the two ends are used in different ways, as we will see. So the main theme of today is to understand conceptually what is a stack, what is a queue, and as we will see, we'll try to implement them using an array implementation. So if you want to know examples of non-data structures, for example, a heap, which I'll not do in a course, trees, you will do it differently in a different place, I guess, graphs, okay, and many other such varieties are not examples of linear lists, because there is no linear ordering amongst all these elements. You can't order them on a line. So going back now, or coming back to stack, if you're hearing for the first time, these are described by the characteristic of the element which comes in last is the one who leaves first. So it's the last in, first out list. So let's look at some real life examples. If you have been in a big restaurant where they keep hot plates, you know, and they use it to serve the people who are coming up in a buffet like scenario, the plates are kept one over the other, and the expectation is, or the desirable thing is, to lift the plate on top of the stack without disturbing anything. If you want to lift a plate from the bottom or from the middle, it is not an expected thing. It's quite possible that the entire arrangement may fall and you may break plates. So that's really an example of a stack where you pull out the one at the top, and clearly the one at the top should also have come in last, because you can't insert a plate in the middle very easily. Similarly, if you are seen at an airport, the way they track in the trolleys, okay, so they push one inside the other, and the one which is outside is probably the one which is pushed in last. You pull out one trolley and then you move, and so on. So a stack is characterized by an organization in which the element who joins last is the one who leaves first. So LIFO is one word description of this data structure. Now, stack is a linear list, which means a linear collection. Stack should have a first element, a last element, and so on, being a linear list. The more important property of a stack is the end which is active. Okay? So the element on top of the stack is very important. This is where you operate. You want to push something onto a stack, or you want to add something to a stack, you add it at the top. You want to remove anything from a stack, you remove also the element at the top. So the top is the distinguished member of the stack, which is directly, you know, accessible when you try to access a stack. You can't access anything below the top directly. You're not supposed to. Then you're not working as a stack. There are two basic operations. One, the stack grows when you push new elements onto it, or you put new elements onto it. Stack people call it a push. If you want to describe a stack, I have an existing stack. I have an element over which the stack is built. I take the element and push it on top of the stack. We'll have a syntax for it even without, you know, describing a realization of that. Similarly, like the stack grows, it's also important that the stack will shrink. The stack will go down in size. Okay. So what happens when people want to pull out things from the stack? They call it a pop operation. So the pop operation will have a stack, and somebody will say pop the stack, as a result of which the top element will leave the stack and the stack will change. It will become one less than what it was before. So now comes the important, you know, two important things which I did not mention in the previous slide, but you can go back to slide 21. If you are pushing elements onto a stack, and if stack has a finite size, what happens when the stack is full, when there is no more space? It is possible that I have only a finite amount of space and you have pushed the stack to its full capacity. Then the push will fail. So the push is conditional. If the stack is not full, is not reached its max limit, then you can push on it. You cannot push otherwise. This is called a stack overflow if the stack is full. Similarly, when you want to delete an element, you cannot do that unless and until the stack is non-empty. How do you delete from an empty stack? So people in the stack world say you cannot delete from an empty stack. That's supposed to be an error. The stack is underflowing. It doesn't have element. So the bottom line is that a stack starts as an empty collection. You have nothing in it. You push, the stack grows. You pop, the stack reduces. And in this manner, you essentially, or we essentially, solve an application problem, which I'll take up later. So coming back to summarize, if you want to summarize a stack, the operations that I have said are, okay, I'll repeat because they're not on the slide here. You create a stack, that's the first thing, we'll see how we do that. Then you push on a stack, basic operation, the stack grows. You pop from a stack, the stack reduces. You can ask any time a Boolean operation, is the stack full? We call it is full. It will say yes or no. If it returns true, then the stack is indeed full. You cannot do a push. If it is false, then there is capacity and you can do a push. Is full is not true. Similarly, you have an is empty. If the stack is empty operation will return true, false otherwise. Many designers have asked for a special operation called a peek. Peek is like peeping into something. So peeking into a stack says that I want to look at the top element. I cannot anyway see anything below it. But I don't want to pop it. I want to have a look what the top is. And then I'll decide, or we will decide. Do I want to do a pop? Do I want to do a push or something else? So a peek is a safe access to a stack which shows you the value of the top element without changing the stack, no delete, nothing. So this is about the basic all operations of a stack. And I'm going to move away from slide 24 because I'm only doing array implementation and go straight to my slide 25. So what does an array implementation mean? That my elements will be put into an array. The stack will grow in an array, the stack will shrink in an array, everything will happen inside the array. So I have decided to have a stack of max size 100. You can change that, you can make it 1000, 10,000, they are fine. Okay. So the array is where the stack elements will decide, so I have to choose a finite size, I have chosen 100. And look at the bottom, the last line int s100 semicolon says I create an array of integers named s whose size is 100 and it's just an integer array, but we are going to use it like a stack. So we will build the machinery so that this integer array exactly behaves like a stack and supports only those 5-6 operations on which a stack is utilized or operated. The next one says that I now need to create a field of a stack which is something more than just the 100 elements of the array. So we observe that as elements are added, the stack will grow. Okay, and the elements are in the stack. So what is an empty stack? Can I say that a stack which has some, you know, which is uninitialized, which has some garbage values, is just an empty stack? The answer is no. A stack without a top is not definable. So what we do is we define a top of the stack, and since elements are going to come in the various index positions of the array, we will say my stack is empty by saying my top, which is an index, is -1. Okay? So there is no capital S -1. This is not a valid index in a conceptual sense. So we say my index is -1 or top is -1 and this is an empty stack. If I want to access an element on top of the stack, we will do capital S and access the top element from the stack, or TOS I have said. So S bracket TOS is the actual top of the stack, is what we want to do. So that's what it says. So I use a separate variable called top. Now this is the constraint, as you can see. I have 100 element array, capital S, as one part of a stack definition, and I need another data member to designate the top element, so I'll have to use an integer index top, which is what I have done. So let's move on and see how it looks like in the next slide. So I go to slide 27. Now this is the visual picture. So look at the picture and ignore the English above it. In test capital 100 shows that there is an array S0 to S99 and I have put all zero values in it. Okay? It is by choice. You could put some other values. But this does not define a stack. The stack is defined by using another int top which is set to -1. So the point is that if top is -1, then this denotes my stack to be empty. There is nothing in the stack. If top is a valid index, anything between 0 and 99, then that is the top element on the stack. This is what we will see in a short while. So look at this simple picture. We are going to put something on the stack. The previous slide's picture starts off with array S is full of zeros, 0 through 99, top was -1, and I'm going to repeat loudly what it would have happened since I cannot draw what I want. So I do insert 20. Okay. So when I do insert 20, we'll have a syntax. We will say t.push -1. Assume that this is an error. This is actually an error. It should be s.push and s.push20 and s.push -10. Why? Because S is the name of my array. I can probably correct it. Let me just check out whether I have used an array stack T. Oh, yeah. So this is okay. Let me get back. On slide 27, I've defined a data structure called stack T. Stack is a new type, which I have not said very explicitly. Okay. So everything will happen on stack T from the outside. Conceptually, I have a stack. And we have internally an array and a member top. So you can see there's something to show and there is something inside. Right, just like an elephant has it. It has one set of teeth to eat and another set of teeth to show its treasure, the ivory, whatever. So therefore I'm right here, T is the stack and I do a push on the stack, T dot push. But what will happen internally? What will happen internally is this 20 will go and occupy the position S of 0, the place for it, and I will make top equal 0. After the first push, index top has become 0, the position where the top element is, and S of 0 has become 20. I do another push, which is the next command, t.push -10, put another element on the stack. So I do that. In doing it, I have to put it in the next consecutive location. So -10 goes to S of 1, and top, which was 0, now moves to 1. So the value 1 has been set to top. This is the basic semantics of a stack and its manipulation through an array. I hope you got the idea that every time I put an element, I move the top index to put where the actual value has come. So if someone looks at this stack, you will say S0 is 20, S1 is -10, S2 is 0, S3 is 0, S99 is 0. The stack, the array is full. But that's not what it is. As a stack, it has only two elements, which you don't know. But you know that the top element is -10, and that is for sure, because S bracket top gives you -10. And that's all about. So this is a pictorial view. It would have been great if I could draw and show it to you in slower motion. So assume that your stack already has two elements. Top is 1. The elements on the stack are S of 0 is 20. S of 1 is -10, I'm on slide 29, and you say, or we say, pop an element from the stack which is T. The internal organization is an array and top, the stack is capital T. So if you do T dot pop, what will happen is, this value -10 will be shown out as a display. So it will be thrown out. Okay, so this will be returned. The value on top of the stack is returned when you pop a stack. But that's not enough. The top has moved. You have the top, current top is now 20 because the -10 has vanished. So what do? We will move top one element behind, or we'll do top equals top -1. So once you do that, top points to 0, element value 20. Okay, even though -10 remains at one location, it does not matter, it is not accessible, and you return the value -10 as a result of. Okay, so I'm going to go slow now. Now this is my way of implementing a class. Okay, so I'm going to introduce a class to which we can operate stacks. So I'm assuming you are all familiar with how to define a simple class. It's a very simple, straightforward class. So constant max stack equals 10 says I want to operate my stack with only 10 elements. That's it, it's a constant value. The type def you can see later. Okay, so type def is a way in which I can parameterize this whole code by a name which I'm going to use. So we read it completely, it says type def string item underscore type. Type def is a keyword which the language understands. String is a regular data type which is already defined, and the name which comes after is basically something which I am giving for the purpose of my code. So it essentially says string is a given type and item underscore type will represent only string. This is another way of defining item type. So item type is string, that's all I'm saying. Okay, ignore if you know it, if you haven't understood it, it's not crucial. Class stack followed by a brace, and the brace ending brace will come later, defines the complete stack, is a complete definition of the stack. Why private? Because I don't want to tell somebody that my stack is implemented as an array. By tell, I don't mean physically tell. I don't want that person to utilize this information. You can see, I can see, you can also see that my S max stack array, S10 array, is basically an array of item type, or in other words, an array of strings, right? Because string is same as item type. So substituted, it reads as string S of 10, but I've just used these variables to make it more general. The next is int of top. This is another data member. So I need a top and index, and I need an array, both of which have been already declared as a part of the private definitions of the class stack. These are data members. Now, typically the function members are supposed to be public. So whoever creates a stack using my definition or this definition should be able to operate with it. So look at the constructor. The constructor is going to create a stack which is of the kind I said. Top is set to -1, so the stack is empty. That is the indication of stack is empty. And since I have a stack of max stack number of elements indexed by 0 to max stack -1, I'm going to put a null string in each element of this stack. So S of I is a null string. Why null string? Because it's a decent safe initialization. It's a stack of strings, and I'm going to put the null string everywhere as a default. So observe, the next is the most fundamental operation on a stack, which is a push. They are all inside the definition of the class stack. I have not left the scope of definition. This says push is the name of the operation. It returns void, it doesn't return anything. And push requires an argument whose type is item underscore type, string to be more exact, that's what it is defined as, and the name of the string is item. So if you want to push something on the stack, you have to give me a string whose name is item, and will push the string onto the top of the stack if everything goes well. This is another member function called isFull, we'll define it later. It says if isFull is true, that means the stack is indeed full, there is no more capacity, then I give a message, else I actually do the operation of push. So I look at where top is. If top is, let's say, 5, I make top equal 6, and then an S of top at the 6th location of the array, I put the new string that you have passed me as an argument. So observe, I first increment top. The current top, stack top, is pointing to the top of the stack. A push will change the top. So I first increment, create the place where the top is going to go, and then I put that new element at the top over there. Very straightforward, no issues by and large. And except if the stack is full, it cannot be an error. This one is more important typically, the type pop. So observe that this returns an item type, it returns a string, the topmost stack of the string. So pop has a return type, same as what the stack is of, which is item underscore type. Again, if the stack is empty, gives an error message. Else, It first copies the element on top of the stack into the element which is to be returned, name is elm, sets top back by minus 1. So clearly if it is empty, which means top was already minus 1, you will never make it minus 2. This fellow will make sure. However, if it's a one element stack, which means top is 0, then it still goes through, it makes top minus 1, but returns the element and leaves you with an empty stack. So for all boundary cases, this pop operation will go through fine, provided the stack is not empty to begin. Peak is very similar, so I'll skip. Let's look at these two simple operations. Is empty. When is the stack empty? It says return the result of comparing top with less than 0. If top is negative, return that the stack is empty. You observe the condition is more general. I could have said return top equal minus 1, but I'm not worried. We have said if top is negative, it cannot actually be anything other than minus 1, but ignore, we will return the stack as is empty as true. Similarly, if the top has already reached the position of max stack minus 1, the highest array index, then the stack is full. So we have these few operations coming back, is empty, is full, peak, pop, and I've given one more, which is push, and of course constructor. Our first simple definition of a stack class is complete and ready to use as a stack. So I go to slide 33, where you can see the kind of use we can make of this implementation. So this could be, for example, a part of a main program. How do I create an object of my class? So I just give the name of my class, which is stack, and put an object name that I want, which is S. So what will stack S create? Okay, what will actually happen when this command is compiled by the compiler? So what he will do, he will take this small s. Now you can go back to my definition and figure out what it will do. If you look at the creation of the stack, the constructor, for which max stack has been defined as, I'm going one more slide back, on 30, max stack is 10. Okay. With this, go to the constructor, which is on page 31, slide 31. It creates an array. The name of the array is also small s, which has nothing to do with the name outside. So an array of 10 elements named through s0 to s, and a separate element top, one more scalar integer variable to minus 1 is what it will do. So coming back now on slide 33, the single line stack S does lots of stuff. It creates an array which is S0 through S9. It creates a top, and both of these will access it by inside S. Right? So S dot S of 0 refers to the 0th element on the array S inside the stack S. S dot top will talk about the value of the data member top inside stack S. So using this name S, I can access the array or I can access the top, whichever I want. So the single stack S command has created the right array implementation of a stack S. Subsequently, this while loop is a very common way of writing things. If you don't know how many strings you want to give, suppose I want to give 5 strings or 500 strings or 5000 strings, I can just write in C++ like this. A very popular way of writing. So while C in greater than str, the while loop will execute till there is a string to read. When there is no string to read, the end of the file occurs. This is false and the while loop is quit. So you can give as many number of strings you want, all of them will get pushed it into the stack S. However, we know the stack has a size of 10. So after the 10th element, the 11th element will keep saying stack. That is part of the implementation. Because max stack is 10, this C in greater than str cannot execute for more than 10 times. Okay. So basically there will be a problem of stack overflow. Then the next while loop basically checks if the stack is empty or not. If it is not empty, then he shows you the value at top of the stack. And then it deletes, pops it. And this loop will, entire execution will empty out the stack, and you will come out with an empty stack this would have also displayed the stack from the last element to the first element by showing you the top element through peak, deleting it, showing the next top, deleting it, showing the next top, and you will see the elements of the stack, okay, in the LIFO order once you have put it. But if this code goes through, then our stack machinery is working. Why? Because we have checked constructor to the first statement, stack s. We have checked push to the while loop body. We have checked is empty by virtue of the condition of the while loop. We have tested for peak. We have tested for pop. And push in turn will make sure that is full is also operational. So all the four, five, six member functions, including the constructor, will get. So before I go to the template class, I think I would have already been talking for about an hour. So maybe if you have any quick questions. Okay, so somebody has asked, I think Kamala has asked, plus please use C code for discussion. Okay, it's very difficult to do good class design, you know, with linked list and all through C. So I will stick to C++. But if you want to use C, you have to replace my classes with structs and you can continue using them. And there will be changes. So I suggest if you want to do good data structures, while C is okay, C++ is much more, you know, friendly and useful, easier and pleasanter to code later on. Okay, kindly, what are the current research topic in data structures? Okay, the current research topics in data structures are for new applications. Okay, so there is no fixed thing. You think of a new application and a new need for a data structure comes. Data structures are typically coming up in different areas. Okay, for example, graphics, image processing people have their own kinds of data structures. The networks people will have their own data structures and so on. So data structures typically are not an area of research by themselves. They are a means to solve a research problem elsewhere. So you do research in a certain area and then you discover a data structure which solves that problem. For example, I work in the area of compilers, and depending on the compiler problem that I want to solve, optimization issues, I will design a data structure which suits me. Typically, graphs are very popular, but then you know, you don't do research per se in data structures today. Okay, is it peak or peep? Actually, it's called peak for whatever reason. This is to Tarun, P-E-E-K, that's the standard word, so I've used it. Its function is more like peeping, but it's not a peeping Tom because you are genuinely allowing him to look at the top of the element, right? It's not by accident, it's by design. So they call it a peek. Okay, what are the example of stacks? I'm going to do a lot of examples. There are many, many, many examples, so I'll not cut it short now. Okay, stacks and queues are heavily used in systems programming almost all over. Stacks are used, for example, in compilers. Stacks are used in operating systems. When you do a function call, you can't translate if you don't have a stack. Queues are used in operating systems. Queues are used in many other applications and so on. You can even use it in other applications which you are trying to code, which may not be direct computer science. Okay, so there will be a lot of applications of stacks and queues. I'll probably throw some light today before the end of the lecture. Okay, so I think I've answered many of the questions. Applications of queue and stack. Okay, what is CRR and is this same as Cout or not? Oh, I wish I had my pad to explain. Okay, so it's like this. If you know Unix, this makes a lot of sense. If you don't, then I'll still try to explain. So in the Unix Linux system, every process, which means every running program, you know, has three defined channels for interaction. One is the scene that you see. Scene is for input. When the program wants to read in values from outside, you use C, right? Whereas when you use C out, when you want to throw the value back on the as an output to the as output of the program, where do you use CRR? As the name suggests, it is primarily meant to display error messages from a program. Unfortunately, all the three are by default mapped to the screen. So basically, when you key in values, you actually key in values from the keyboard, which are flashed on the screen and then goes to the program. When you do C out, the values of the variables are displayed on the screen. When you do CRR, even then the values are displayed on the screen. So what is the difference? The difference is they need not be, you know, thrown back to the screen. If you know a bit of shell programming, very, very basic, I can take an executable program, take its input from a file, produce its output to another file, and produce its error messages to yet another file. Okay, so that the three channels are completely separate, they don't clutter each other. So I don't see anything on my screen because I've used files. So CERR is best used to display error messages from any executable program if it was written properly. For example, if you do a compiler, you run the compiler G++, okay, the error messages and the output all come on the same screen and they can clutter you. But if you redirect the error message, then you will get it on a separate screen. So a small summary, maybe when my pad starts working today or the next time, I'll be able to write and show you the difference between Cout and CERR and how, if you know both, you can make your life much more comfortable. So CERR, believe me, is definitely useful when you write. Okay, example of user defined data type, somebody has asked. So for example, what I'm doing as stack is a user defined data type right now. I'm developing it slowly. Somebody has asked a question, what happens if the array uses the memory space exceeding its limit when that memory space is used by some other process? Is this related with segmentation fault? Okay, so this is a question by DNI from TCE. So when the array basically, so I need again my, for a simplistic description, that every process is given an area, a footprint in memory under which you must work. Okay. However, when the program is running, a program can make any access to any part of the memory. It is the operating system's job to ensure that any memory access made outside the memory given to the user is basically a serious fault. Okay, it's like this. Suppose I want to, you know, buy something. You know, I am supposed to pull out my purse and pay money. Yeah? I should not pull out my neighbor's purse and pay. That's not allowed, right? So similarly, it's my memory in which I can do whatever I want. And that is decided by the OS. It'll give you MBs or whatever, KBs of memory, typically large enough MBs. So normally you will never run out of memory. However, I'm sure you are done programming. You know that you can write infinite loops. The program keeps executing and can actually create a lot of problems in which it creates or goes beyond its allotted memory. So segmentation fault means that you have accessed a memory segment which was not allocated to you. Whom you have interfered with does not matter. Is it the OS's memory? Is it another process's memory? Is it some other process's memory? It does not matter. Another memory by your own process, because you can run many processes, it does not matter. Segmentation fault means you have actually accessed something which is not given out to you. And this is typically a memory access fault. Okay, Singara is asking a question. This is the last question I'll take. He or she is saying you said accessing array of bound is an error on part of the language designer. No, it's not what I'm saying. Again, let me correct. Accessing array out of bound is an error on part of the program writer. But the designer can take a stand. The designer can say to people like us who are implementers that you have to ensure that any memory access outside the declared memory should be a compile time error. If you know Java, Java exactly does that. In Java, you cannot create an array access beyond the range. Okay? So it's not difficult. Anybody can do it. Any third, fourth year BTech student can actually implement it. What is the catch? The catch is that every array access that you make, the compiler will put insert a runtime check. Is AI greater than equal to 0 and less than equal to 20 or whatever you have defined? If it is so, it allows. If it is not, it sort of removes. So it's basically the cost that you pay. You know, for every array access you are making, several cycles of, you know, instruction wastage to check if the array access is valid or not. So Java said we want to do it because it's a safety concern. C++ said it is not a safety concern, it is your problem. So therefore, the compiler allows you to make an access outside without indicating an error. And therefore, the runtime system anyway will not let you go. It will give you a fault, segmentation fault, and throw you off. So the point is, if I knew at the time of writing the program or compiling that this is an error, I would have corrected it. I might have lost valuable time and effort, by not being warned by the compiler. So it's nobody's fault, it's just the language designer took a decision that you write your programs carefully. If you think you are accessing memory beyond, you can put a check. If EI greater than this, less than this, I'll do it. I am not bothered. So it's just basically the, you know, the division of activity. C++ designers sticking to what C did, said it is not required to do array range check at compile time. But I am told my writing pad is now fully accessible, so let me try it out. I'll try and answer the CERR question that somebody asked. Okay, so, and the difference with Cout. I feel more comfortable with this because I can see what I am doing. Okay, I'm sure the sharpness can be increased. Fine. So let me, you know, give you an example. As I told you, I'm not very comfortable with the Microsoft world. So I'll give my examples will be Linux based. So in Linux operating system or Linux Unix operating systems, you compile a program into an executable called a.out. I presume you know. Okay. So suppose you have an executable file a.out. It could be for any program that you're given. You want to time this program. How much time, run time does this take? Okay, at execution time. It's very useful to do this because we'll be developing a lot of, you know, data structures and code. So here is the syntax or semantics of using time. So you write time, okay, and usually you write a dot out, the program to which you monitor. Right? So if you do this, time is the name of the command which times. What will it time? The second executable, the second parameter, which is the executable program. So a dot out is running under supervision of time, and time will give you some numbers. So the result of this will be, could be like this. So it will give you USR, some time, 00 again, some real, some time, hour, second, minutes, and it will give you something called sys and some time. It will be like this, 0 hour, maybe 1 minute, maybe 22 seconds, whatever, something like this. And it'll also give you the output of a dot out. Output of the program a dot out, because a dot out produces some output. Okay, all of this is coming on the screen. For example, let's say I am not interested in a dot out, but I'm actually interested in only USR, the timing of that a dot out. So here, if you know things well, if you did this, okay, if you understand, great. If you don't too much bother. Here's a dot out. Now you can do something like 2 greater than a file name, okay, and then something like greater than out. Okay, don't worry if you don't understand. All I'm trying to say is that this EERR or 2 greater than, these are typically linked with CERR. This greater than is linked with Cout. So what is happening is there are 2 outputs over here. One is the output of the time command, which is USR real sys time. The other is output of a dot out, which is all on the screen. I don't want to see them together. So time is written in such a way that the output of time comes on the error channel. So this is through CERR. And the output is basically its output channel. Okay, so time is displaying through Cout the output of a dot out, and in some sense displaying its own output through error. Okay, so it's good to have both these channels, CERR for displaying error messages of a program. In this case, of course, it is not an error message, and Cout for genuine output. Maybe if I get more occasions, I'll explain this. But basically, it's good as a programmer to know that I can separate out my error messages from the genuine output messages, and it makes life fairly comfortable. Okay, so before I motivate that, let me give you a small discussion on what is coming up. Okay, some of you may know this. So the motivation for the next part is a very distinctive feature of C++, which is not there in C, and that's the reason why I prefer C. So let's see what I'm trying to say. Suppose as an application, I want a stack of integers. Okay. I also want to define a stack of floating point numbers, floats. And like I did the first time, I also want a stack of strings. Okay, so I want three different stacks. Why? Because the elements are different. The data types, the values that they will hold are different. Okay. How can I use my earlier design? What did I do in my earlier design? If you look back, I had a class stack. Okay, it's similar to struct stack if you are working in the C world. Now this class stack somewhere had a type def string, and I put something, I had used item type. So this was the way of saying that my item type, the num type of elements which will appear on the stack, I have decided it to be string, and my whole class was written out like this. If I wanted to create a type of a stack of floats, all I needed to do was rewrite entire stack and then write it as float. Okay, and repeat the whole definition, yet another stack. But then you cannot define two stacks, so maybe I'll call it stack float or something. I'd give it a new name. Okay, this is the C type reuse typically of existing code. So you define item type as string, pull out a stack. Next time you copy paste stack, change string to float, change the name stack to something else, and then rewrite it. The third time you can do it over integers. So effectively I have to copy paste class stack. What I need to change? I need to change the name, number one. I need to change this thing which is two, and look in the body if any other changes are required. And then I'll have three definitions of three names of stacks, and all of this will get ready. C++ people said this is a very frequently required operation. We don't want this. We want a different mechanism through which. So here is, let's say, my class definition. If you have not seen this before, be slow, there is no great hurry. So C++ use something called a template class definition. This is what I'm going to open up. Okay, it will come quite a few times in my course. So this template class definition is designed once by the user. You write it with great care. I'll show you it. It's there in the next slide. Now, once you have a template class definition, you can use this by saying, okay, now I want integers. Okay, so I'm going to use it. This fellow will create an integer stack because I'm using a stack. Who will generate this? This will be generated by the compiler, not by you and me. Okay, and it will be ready for use. Therefore, the name template. Next time I say, no, I also want it for float. So I'll use the same template class definition and tell him, okay, I give you float. He will create a float stack for you. Okay, again generated by the compiler and ready to use. If you wanted a third type, which I said strings, the same thing. I have to just use this definition, and here comes a stack of strings. So as you can see, there's a huge or great reuse of code, which is possible by virtue of this reuse of code, which is very important. So this is the philosophy. A template class does not stick to a particular type. He said, give me a type, I'll produce you an object of that type. The object is not a simple object. It's a complete class stack. It creates a class. The integer stack, this is a class, a new type. Float stack is a class. String stack of strings is a class. So I write one class and then I generate classes out of it. It's a much higher level abstraction which this language uses. It may sound very heavy if you are seeing it for the first time. So with this now I go back to what I am doing over here. So what is the purpose? The purpose now is to show you how this template class works. So basically this is not done the first time from scratch, but we first build one class, let's say the class stack which I had. So I'll go back a few slides and I'll keep flipping between these two. So my class stack, if you go to slide number 30, is what I did. So the class definition starts after the type def. You see in red, class stack, opening braces, private colon, this is where the stack started. But what was the problem with this? I had to put this item type and define it once. If I want to change it from string to int, I have to do it again. So the real eureka step or the real discovery step of C++ was that I don't have to put this as item type or any such thing and fix it here. Can I not say, can I create a stack of type capital T and be there? I will not tell you what type T is. Okay. So I will create a stack of an unknown type T, which I'll not tell you now when I'm defining. So instead of item type, I would like to use a variable T for a type. That's the first major step. And once you can do that, you rewrite the entire machinery using that variable T. So let me go back to the slide. So go to slide number 34 and observe that before class stack, we have used this template class T. See in red. But this is the way a template class is introduced. The template is a fixed keyword. The angular braces are put after it, and depending on how many parameters I want to abstract, I have to put those type variables. So I've used class T. I could have used class T, class U, class X, whatever. For our application, we need one class. So this is saying I'm creating a not a normal class, but a template class, and my variable of type is capital T. Okay? And then I write class stack and continue. Now look at the private declaration. Earlier we said it was int s of max stack or string s of max stack or item type s of max stack. Now we are going to say in the same T, okay, unknown T. So this will create an int or array s max stack of type T, which we don't know at the time of writing, and I don't care. Okay. Observe that the constructor says stack. And it says top equal to minus 1. That's all. It does not try to initialize the elements. Why? Because I don't know T, right? If it's integer, I'll initialize with 0. If it's a car stack, I may initialize with a single blank. If it's a string stack, I may initialize with a null string. Floating point, I may initialize with something else. So since the initialized value depends on the type, and I don't know the type, I don't want to initialize. I just set top equals minus 1, which means the stack is empty. Then keep saying void push T item. Now I don't know what type T is. It may be integer, string, float, whatever. So I say it is type T. Be happy with it. The rest of the code observe is completely independent of T. Because this is just trying to see how to increment top, how to put a value over there. So long as item is of the right kind, there is no issue. So really speaking, in push only one change, capital T. In the declaration of the type is become capital T. Only two changes you have seen so far. Look at pop. Pop returns an element of the type of elements on the stack, but I don't know the type. It is T. So here is T. What is the type of element? Capital T. I don't know. I don't want to change it. Okay. And then look at peak, capital T. So I'm going to create now a template stack from which stacks will be created, and I'm going to show you that in a short while. Okay, and then bool is empty, is full. There is something else coming over here which I'll come back a little later. This observe is a function outside the class definition, and it's a function template. Skip it for the moment, I'll come back later. So I'm on slide 37 and I've looked at the stack class definition so far, which is that of a template. Ignore slide 38, is not central to the theme. And let me now come to slide 39 and I'll go back to my writing to explain what is happening over there. Okay, so I am trying to define a very general purpose stack, which is a stack, which is a template class. I'll borrow the basic definition. So we used these words, template, class, capital T, okay. And I have shown you the changes, so I will not highlight them. Basically, we have used capital T in place of type of elements on the stack. The template class is only something like a pattern. It does not do anything unless you do something more. So if you go back now to the slide which uses the main program on slide 38, you observe that the usages are, I will go back to the slide to explain. I'm just copying it out from there. So let me come back. So I have just added something else also. These are the declarations which you write as a user program. Okay, I'll explain one, the other should be clear. So when you use the first one, stack, angular bracket open, int, okay, angular bracket closed, s1, what happens? At this point is the compiler which is working. The compiler opens the template. Okay, or compiler uses the template definition, which is this. Okay, and it says, okay, what is this fellow wanting? He wants an int. So he says this T is resolved to or unified to int. Okay, and then he creates a new stack, which is like this, class stack, okay, bracket int, or angular bracket int, and everything here T is replaced by int, and a physical code is created. Is this clear? So at this point, once this declaration has been processed by the compiler, you have a real stack, not a template stack, and the real stack is stack int. Similarly, the second one will create a concrete stack, which is stack of string. This will be same as what I had given you there, a concrete stack. And similarly, the third one will create stack, which is the name of the stack, stack angular float and the full definition. So again, I'll go back to the earlier slide. I defined this once, the template class. I can open the template as many times as I want. I've opened it 3 times so far. So 3 physical stacks are created, which I have showed you. What do I do now? I can just use them as if I declared them. So use them liberally if your design is correct. What does it mean? So I can take this S1, I can do a push over it. This, remember, is an integer stack. So I can do this, it will go through. No issues. Push function from stack integer is created and goes through. I can do S2.push qEEE. Okay, this is a common string, all of us know. This will also go through, but this will be added to stack S2. I can take the stack S3 and I can push for element that it's supposed to expect 2.45. So the first one, I can keep pushing integers, it will go through because S1 is a stack of integers. Okay. S2 is a stack of strings, so something like this, strings will go through. S3 is a stack of floats, so floats will go through. Any number, you can keep doing this. You can do S1.pop. to get out elements. You can do S2.peek to figure out what is on top of S2, or you can do S3.isEmpty to figure out if the stack is empty or not. Okay, all of these are ready. So coming back, why I did this? Because I know the application that I'm going to give you later, and I'll explain it in a very brief while. which is use of stacks. Okay, don't ask me the full detail, I'll do that later in expression evaluation. Okay, so let's create a synthetic expression. 30 plus 2 into 5, okay, minus 6 divided by 4, something like this. What is supposed to be done? One is supposed to find out the value of this. So someone who knows the rules of the game, he knows that this star has to be done first, producing the value 10. 4 by 6 will produce the value 1. Okay, so this will become 30 plus 10, 40 minus 2. The answer is 38. And then the calculation mistake, ignore it. How do you do using any expression in a stack? So people do this. People say, I will create two stacks. One is a stack of operands or values. I'll call it operands. And the other is a stack of operators. Operators. You observe now, these two are two different stacks. One will have number, the other will have strings or characters. You can't mix them up together. So I pick up the first number, which is 30, put it in the operand stack. The next is an operator, so I put it on the operator stack. The next is the number 2, so I put it on the value stack. Next is star, so I put it on the operator star, because I'm just stacking. Okay, and then comes 5, so I put it on the operand stack. I've reached here. After this, I get this strange operator, which is the subtraction operator. So people know that subtraction is less important than multiplication. Multiplication is more important than addition, so I stack. Once I get an operator which is less important, I don't stack. I do some activity. What do? I pop this and I pop two operands. So I'll do 5 into 2 or 2 into 5. Okay, so I get a new value stack which becomes now 30. Observe, I pop 2 and 5. I pop the operator star. I produced a new value 10. I put it over here. And my operator stack becomes plus. Now they will say, okay, what about the minus? It's still hanging out. This fellow has not been processed. Okay, now they will say minus is less important than plus. So please evaluate plus also. The result will be 40 and an empty stack. And then it continues. Okay, so I don't want to give you the full method, but it gives you an idea that behind every program that you write, every expression that you write, somebody is using multiple stacks to evaluate the expression. Okay, so this is one of the very popular example of a stack. And to do this, I need to create different stacks or stacks of different types. In C++, I can just write one template definition and create any type of stack out of it. That is the great advantage. Okay. So let me return back to my slides. So I'm going to skip material I've already covered. So all this up to 41 I skip, and then I come to the data structure Q. Okay, so now I come to Q. The general theory of Q I have given out there. I'm going to short circuit it so that I can speed up a little bit. So Q is a linear based data structure, so I'll not too much worry about details. The point is that Q is a first in, first out data structure. What does it mean? Just like we stand in a queue in the bus stop or a railway station or in a shopping mall or wherever, is the same natural thing happening in computer. So I mean, I'm also going to explain very, very quickly a queue using an array. So suppose I choose some 10 elements, I'm not going to show all. Let me call this array itself as Q, in which my elements which come in will reside. Now, as you know, in real life, Q has two active ends. Yes, if you are situated on a sales counter, you want to pay and come out from somewhere, then the fellow is at top of the queue gets serviced, right? So people are serviced at one end of a queue, and this person should be the senior most in the queue, come first, okay? Serviced at one end, and you basically join at the other. Small example. Suppose I'm going to use numbers just for clarity. Suppose I have three numbers, 23, 10, and 15, who join in a queue. Okay, so how will my implementation conceptually look like? I have assumed that I have a 10 element queue. So this is my queue, denoted by the array capital Q. So what happens? Along with the array like stack, we used one pointer, which was top, or one index, which told me where the top of the stack is. But a queue has two ends. Okay, one for deletion, from where people are serviced, this is the senior most, and the other is for insertion. The name where deletion takes place in a queue is called the front of the queue. And where you insert or join is called the rear of the queue. So what is an empty queue? Empty queue we're going to visualize. There are many ways, by saying front equals minus one and rear is also minus one. Okay. No valid index, nothing from 0 to 9. You could have said 10 also, 10 is not a valid index. Okay, but we have chosen minus 1, just below 0. Why this? Because they are saying there is no front, because front is not 0, doesn't point to anything in the queue. Nobody in the queue is at the top of the queue. Nobody at the queue is at the end of the queue. These are all fictitious indices, and therefore it represents an empty. Okay, so what happens when 20 joins? So this will be talked about as insert 20. So when insert 20 comes, 20 joins at some point of the queue, he becomes this. When 20 joins, you're supposed to join from the rear. So what happens? The rear points now to the actual element who has joined. And where is front? Nothing has happened to front. Nobody has gone away. So it continues to be minus 1 at a fictitious empty position. What happens when 10 also joins the queue? So I put this element 10 on the queue, and now rear now moves to this position 10. Sorry, position 1. 15 also joined the queue. So when 15 joined the queue, my rear would have come here instead of this. At this point, suppose I say delete. I want to delete an element. Since I want to delete, only the first element can go. He is standing in the queue for a long time. So the new scenario is, after the delete, course 20 remains here. In array, you can't really wish it away. It will be there. But the front will now point here after the deletion. Okay, and the rear will point here. So this is what we try to manipulate in a typical simple queue. So both front and rear are used, one to denote the element which is to be serviced now and the element which has last joined by rear. What is the difference? The front is one element ahead of the actual front. Remember, 20 has already gone. So when front is here, essentially this is the front of the queue. This fellow is the real front to be serviced. When front was minus 1, the real element to be serviced was 0, 1 ahead. So front is 1 behind, and okay. So front is 1 behind, and the rear is actually the rear element of the queue. Okay. So since I'm going to do a particular design, let me tell you why I'm going to skip from here. So I'm going to skip from here because a queue like this is not going to be very useful. Suppose I have a very small queue of size say 3 only. Okay, is our choice. So there are only 3 elements in the queue which are 0, 1, 2. Can I do this? Insert 10, delete. Insert 20, delete. And then insert 30, and then delete. So I'm doing both the operations alternately. Okay. What would be the situation of the queue? So the empty queue was, I'll use F for front minus 1, R for rear minus 1. This was a starting point and empty queue. So here's a question for you. What exactly will happen after all these 6 operations has gone through? Of course, 10 came first, should have sat here, 20 should have sat here, 30 should have sat here, okay, in 0, 1, 2. But since there were 3 deletes and 3 inserts, what is the value of F and what is the value of R? The first insert will make the value of R equal 0. The second insert makes it 1. I'm just following the inserts. The third insert makes it 2. Okay. So therefore, R's value becomes 2. What is happening to front? Front started with minus 1. This delete made the front 0. This delete make the front 1. And this delete make the front 2. So front equals 2. Okay. So at this point, if you look at it, really speaking, this is not a correct way of looking at this. Really speaking, there is no element on the queue, no element on the queue, no element on the queue. And both front and rear are pointing here. Over there. So what happens here? You observe that the queue is empty. Why is the queue empty? Because after rear you cannot insert any element. There is no 3 element here. There is no index 3. Okay. So this queue is only used for classical discussions. We do not use such a queue in real practice. What do we use in real practice is what I am going to discuss now. Before the implementation. So what people say is that a much smarter way to implement an array based queue is to use a circular queue. If you have not seen this before, see it carefully. I will continue with a 3 element circular queue. It's just that the array has been laid out in a circle. So these are the positions 0, 1 and 2. Okay. So what will happen is, if I use my earlier 6 operations, I will come back to this scenario where both F and R point here, which is typically the scene of an empty queue. But I also know that this is a little dangerous scenario. So let me do it slowly. So when I did insert 20, I would have got 20 here. Okay. Suppose the first one was 20. Second time I did 30, so I got a 30 here. So what is the scenario now? After 20, F has become 0, R has become 0. Let me correct this. I think I should give you the operation. I'm jumping steps. I should not do that. So here is insert 20, here is delete, okay, and here is insert. These are all conceptual, so the actual functions, this may not work. 30 followed by delete. So let's see slowly what will happen. So I'll draw the circular queue slowly. So here is my first circular queue. 0, 1 and 2. F and R were both minus 1. Now F remains minus 1, but R becomes 0 and the number 20 gets in here. Once you delete, after the deletion, what will happen? F will also become 0 and R will become 0 okay, and you will get an empty queue because 20 has gone. The scenario for this is, so in this case, F has become 1, sorry, F has become 0, my mistake, and R is also 0. Yeah, and observe there is nothing on the queue because both are here. So typically, we typically represent an empty queue by F equals R. These are typical conditions to show that whenever the front catches up with the rear, this is an empty queue. So when is the queue full? There are many ways of doing this. What people do is they will say, since it's a circular queue, please do not fill up fully. Okay, so suppose this was a scenario. So this is my this is my rear, and let's say this is my front. Okay. The front is less than rear, which is fine. Now I can put an element here and fill up the whole, you know, queue, because only a 3-element queue, but I will not do that. At this stage itself, I will say the stack is full. You know the reason why? Because if you put an element here, okay, no, not this. Okay, so here is my rear and here is my, now I do 2 deletes. So when I do 2 deletes, okay, then again my F will catch up with rear. So since we are using in a circular fashion, the advantage is even if the stack scenario is, sorry, the queue scenario is like this, I have, you know, both, if this is my rear, I can put up and use this element as the next element, provided it is element, it's empty. So the next element can be stored here if empty. Okay, so I can keep rotating and I can keep putting values here so long as they are empty. So this is called a circular queue. Circular queue has to be very carefully worked out because you are moving, you are going past it. How do I go past it? So the point is very clear. If this is 3, after 3, where does it go? So the increment of rear after 3 will be rear plus 1 is equal to 4. Okay, so after 4, so after 3 you get, sorry, this is 2. So if you do this, then you get 3. So what is 3 beyond 2? So you do a modulo 3. This is the 3 size of this, you get 0. So after 2, you come and place it in 3, which is basically 0. After 0, if you want, you can place it at 1. So keep rotating in circles. So this is the implementation which I'm going to discuss. So I'll give you, since I have about less than 5 minutes, I'll just quickly go through and tell you what exactly this queue is going to do. So let me go back to my slides. Okay, so I'm going to skip this because I've done all of this. Please read it carefully and tell me if there is a problem now or later. Okay, so this, the slide, for example, 45 in slow motion is showing you why we are choosing certain values of front and rear. 46, 47 are similar. I've already done it. Okay. So these are the pseudocodes, not really in any language, on slide 48, which talks about how do you handle an array queue. Okay, but this is not circular. So observe that you want to insert on slide 48, then rear plus plus, move the rear pointer one step behind, and then put the new element there and your insert is over. If you want to delete, since front is one before the actual front, first increment front and then delete, remove that. Queue is full, figure out if rear has reached the last max stack. If queue is empty, I've given you some conditions. I'll skip 49, I've done it already there. Read at leisure. I treat it as notes, both slides 50, okay, and the slides 52. 52 is an interesting slide, where in slow motion I have shown you how the array works in a circular manner. Okay, so how to interpret this table? My queue has only 4 elements indexed as shown in the first row: Q of 0, Q of 1, Q of 2, Q of 3. Okay. Initially, the values of front and rear are given, and remarks tell you what is the status of the queue. So the first row, which says initially, you observe front is minus 1, rear is minus 1, and this denotes for us an empty queue. Nothing is on the queue. So the indices are both illegitimate. Once you do an insert 10, observe that 10 has gone to Q0. And observe the rear has moved, the front hasn't. The next insert again moves the rear but not the front. Another insert moves the rear but not the front. When you do a delete, the next operation, observe that 10 is thrown back, the top of the first element on the queue, which is put in red, is physically there but not, is not physically, is logically not there but physically there, because the front has been set to be 0. So the first element to be deleted is 20, one more than the front, and the last element is 30, so you are correctly manipulating both. So what is the interesting stuff out here is that after, so look at the last line, insert 40, last but one line. Before that, the position 0 and 1 of the queue are empty because the front pointer has moved and is pointing to 1, which is the second element on the queue. The rear is 5. And when somebody says insert 40, I have already touched the max queue position. But since it is a circular queue, we will install 40 in the position after 5, which is plus 1, 4, modulo 4 is 0. And the queue will start getting filled up like this. Okay. So in my course, I am going to use a circular queue whenever I talk about the queue. Any question that you have now or later, you are welcome. It is a good exercise. It is a much more interesting programming exercise to work with a circular queue. The last part of this course, which was supposed to be the linked list data structure. So this spans from 57 to 75. I don't want to run down because it will not help. Okay, you can see pictorially how a linked list is built. The first observation here, if you are not comfortable with pointers, I'll come back and do it later, that linked lists typically are difficult to use using arrays. So you observe. On slide, for example, 59, there are boxes and arrows between them. Okay? So this is where typically a linked list, which is the main thrust of these modules, will come into play. So let me stop here. I don't want to exceed your time too much. I'll come back and restart with linked list data structure. Okay. But in the meanwhile, you have 1 week. Please read up. Keep all your questions on your mind. And if you want, I can give you my email address over here. You are most welcome. I think it is there on the first slide. Okay, I have not given. So let me give it here. Just here is it. If you have any doubts on the slides or the notes which I keep passing, you can send mails to me, but please use. So I'll take this question which somebody has asked. Linked list is having memory access in different locations. Will this reduce performance when compared to array, which is having contiguous? This is a really a big question, and hopefully by the end, middle of lecture 2, we'll have some answers. Okay, but the answers are not uniform, because really speaking, in real life, you do not have perfect situations. So we will see examples on the second module where people use a mix of linked list and arrays, and you try and use and capitalize on the powers of both. So linked list itself has huge possibilities, but it is used in a different application than where arrays are used. So there are performance penalties for putting things in different locations, but there are performance pluses also. And I think at the right perspective, we should try and compare. So let me say, somebody has said that most students are from the third semester, which is good, but then I think if you are sticking to data structures in a serious manner, then C will not help. I can switch back to C, but I'll have to give up a lot of good things which you should know. It is not important whether you choose C or C++, but it is important that you learn how to program complex applications, okay, as CS students, and I think C++ is the answer. So if you have C questions, you can pass them to me. I'll answer them offhand, but I would strongly advocate you to use C++, because my module 2 cannot be done with C. It will be very, very suboptimal. Okay. However, I'm not going to use too many high features of C++, no derived classes, nothing like that. Okay. So they will be basic bread and butter C++, which are by and large superset of C. But there are features which I really want you to learn to do good programming. Typically for data structures. For programming course, you don't need all of that. But for data structures, you do need powerful language mechanisms. Okay, so I'll stop here. Please read up linear list, the linked list discussions conceptual at the end. Okay, I've also set up a quiz question, which probably your organizers will conduct it for you. Do it and do feel free to send me feedback. Okay, thank you. See you next time.
Thank you. Thank you.